start with just a quick reminder of the absolute value function from our discussion yesterday. It seems like most of you are at least familiar with it. So if I take the absolute value of negative 3, say f of x is absolute value of x means absolute value of negative 3, right? That gives me 3. Absolute value of negative 3 is 3. Absolute value of negative 2 is 2.
Right.
How do we define absolute value?
The distance is from 0.
Exactly. How far away is it from 0? So negative 2 is this way, but how far is it? It's 2 away. 2 away from 0. 2, positive 2, is also 2 away from 0. That's why the absolute value of negative 2 and the absolute value of positive 2 are both 2. So that's how far away they are. Now we have this function g of x. It's very similar to f of x, but it has this -2. So let's see how that affects things. First, let's take note of this. Let's do one example of what it looks like to use g of x. If I just wanted to plug something into g of x, let's say g of -3, just because like, just put negative numbers in there. Mm-hmm. The absolute value of -3, right, put an x in there, and we're going to subtract 2. So notice that part of g of x is exactly the same as f of x. Exactly the same thing happens in g of x as f of x. At some point, we just take the absolute value of the number that we plug in. Took the absolute value of it. If you take the absolute value of negative 3, you get 3. So you see how, like, this part of g of x is all done already?
Mm-hmm.
It's all finished out right there. The absolute value part is done. So to show what g of x is doing, you just take the f of x part and do what with it?
Switch to g of x.
How do we switch it to g of x? What do you mean by that?
So you find the absolute value? I don't know.
Subtract.
No, notice that part of calculating is just the absolute value of negative 3. Well, that's just what we did to figure out f of x. So like this part of it, right here, that's just f of x.
Uh-huh.
That's what f of x is. So we subtract 2 from each of these numbers. That'll give us what g of x is. So f of x does this part of g of x for us. And so we can just take this column and subtract 2 from it. Subtract 2. So 3 minus 2 is 1. 2 minus 2 is 0. 1 minus 2, negative 1. 1 minus 2, negative 2. 1 minus 2, negative 0, 1. And when we plot those points, negative 3, 1. Negative 3, 1. Negative 2, 0. Negative 1, negative 1. 0, negative 2, 1, negative 1, 2, 0, 3, 1. Starting to see what this graph looks like compared to f of x, right?
Right.
This part and this part are parallel, and these two guys here are parallel. And even more specifically, this function, this graph, is, where is it in comparison to the original? It's 2 below. Just move down 2.
And 1, yeah.
Clint?
When do we get a test block?
As soon as everybody has made it up, please stop interrupting class.
Sorry.
Things that don't have to do. If you want to ask that question, just come up to me afterwards. Alright, so this green thing, g of x, is 2 below this function, f of x. So take the absolute value of x and we subtract 2, we get a graph that's 2 lower than just regular old f of x. Let's try another one, very, very similar. So again, f of x, we can call the absolute value of x. It's that V shape that it's at 0, 0, its vertex is at 0, 0. If we call g of x, let's say g of x is the absolute value of x plus 3. So this is going to be individual work. I'm going to make a prediction. What do you think your graph will look like? Then plot some points and see if you were right about what the graph looks like. So, I were absolutely clueless about this. It would be a good time to pay attention, because I'm going to explain it from beginning to end, right up here on the board, for anyone who has any confusion. Okay? So the way this function works, it uses the absolute value. If I were to plug in a number like negative 3 into this function, g of x. Just a second. We're going to put negative 3 into the absolute value part. Then there's plus 3. Alright, so what's the absolute value of negative 3?
3.
It's 3, right? The distance from 0, negative 3 is 3 away from 0. 3 is the absolute value of negative 3 plus that 3 right there is 6. And 2. So I plug negative 2 into g of x, right? negative 2 inside the absolute value, plus 3. What's the absolute value of negative 2?
2.
I'm going to add 3, and we get 5. Negative 1, absolute value of negative 1 is 3. Absolute value of negative 1 is 1, plus 3. 0, absolute value of 0. Plus 3, absolute value of 0, it is 0 away from 0, right? So it's 0 plus 3 is 3. For 1, maybe we don't have to write down this calculation. Absolute value of 1
is 1,
is 1 plus 3
is 4.
Is 4.
5.
So 2 is going to be absolute value of 2. 2 plus 3 is 5. Absolute value of 3 plus 3 is 6. If we were to just plot these, we'd get like a 0, 3, 0 for x, 3 for y, 1, 4, 2, 5, 3, 6. Go the other way, we get negative 1, 4, negative 2, 5, negative 3, 6.
There you go.
So this graph looks remarkably similar to this graph, this black one here, which is just plain old absolute value of x. Nothing else, no extras, not multiplied by anything, nothing added, nothing subtracted. So if I take that plain old absolute value of x and I add 3 on the outside of the absolute value of x, what happens to the graph? How does this graph look compared to that graph in the previous screen?
It's higher on the y-line.
By how much? Higher by 3. It goes up 3. When we did minus 2, it was 2 lower than your regular old absolute value of x. Sarah?
So, can you go back to the other graph?
I sure can.
So, on that one, you keep the negative 3 when you graph, but you use the absolute value to add.
So, we'll talk about negative 3.
Yeah, and then for the gx, that's what you use for like the y.
Right.
So you keep that when you graph it, but you use the absolute value to add it, like the 3 onto it?
Yeah, so the thing that I put into the function is x, and so what I put in was negative 3. And what happened to that negative 3 when I plugged it in was, well, the absolute value of negative 3 is 3, and 3 plus 3 is 6, right? So I put in negative 3, and I got out 6. So negative 3 is the input, and 6 is the output.
Okay.
Did that help?
Yeah.
Okay.
Where's fx on there?
No, it's not there. What would it look like if it were there?
A 0.
Well, yeah, I thought that was just part of it. So.
No, that's a good point. It's not there at all. F of x, right? Like, who said it was at 0? It says 0? Yeah, it's down here at 0. That part that we're referring to that's at 0, we call that the vertex. Vertex. Not a vortex like my...
vortex scope.
So it would look just, well, not just, this looks much better than the blue one. Much straighter.
So
but they do have the same shape, the blue one's just three higher. Richard?
So for every like equation thing, do we just take what the y-intercept is, then dot that, and then just go up on each one?
Okay, so you're making like a general rule. Whenever I see something like this, would this rule apply? What do you guys think? I mean, if we added 5, what do you think that graph would look like?
It'd be 5 higher.
5 higher. If it was -7,
-7 lower.
You think that's a good general rule? Did Bridger hit on something that is,
yeah.
Is it's a good rule? Yeah, so let's write that rule for the function, say, g of x equals the absolute value of x plus,
seven.
Now we want to say something, anything, right? That anything, we use k for that.
Cheers.
Yes.
Back.
Plus k, plus anything. What does that mean the graph is going to look like? Graph will be what?
Parallel.
The absolute value plus k.
Will be vert, no, vert.
Will be f of x plus k, but f of x is the absolute value of x. But, I mean, just like the way it looks, that graph will be...
A v?
What's that?
K.
K higher, right? When we did plus 7, we said it's up 7. When we did minus 4, it's down 4. It'll be k higher. And Bridger gave us a nice way to go about it, like a procedure. If you see plus 9, well, let's just count up 9, put the vertex there, and then make our V from there. So it goes K higher. And that's still really is technically right. Even if K is a negative number, if it was plus negative 5, it would be negative 5 higher, but that actually means since it's negative, it goes down. Bridger?
Are we trying to find out what K is? Or
no. I mean, what k is kind of up to
whoever
writes that problem down.
Okay.
So plus k, whatever k is, that's how much higher you go. And if it's negative, you go down. So that's what it would mean to go higher in a negative number. Okay. Now let's look at a different kind of thing that we could do, how we could alter it. So this probably, if I'm not mistaken, one of your first exposures to this kind of thing. Like, what is happening to the graph? The graph it looks like that original graph, or it's up here, or it's down there. These are called translations. Have you heard translations before?
Yeah.
Translations of shapes, right? So we can translate graphs. We can dilate graphs. We can transform graphs. We can flip graphs. We can all those things with graphs that you may have heard of with shapes. Okay. We're translating these graphs. We'll transform them as well. So absolute value of x plus 3, okay? Notice the plus 3 is inside the absolute value, not outside the absolute value, okay? If my dreams were to come true, this would be my dream, that you make a guess as to what you think will happen to the graph. I think this will happen. Then, just plug in some numbers for x, maybe several numbers for x, plot those points, and see if your guess was right. Just in case you're not sure what it looks like to plug a number into this function, say negative 7. That would be negative 7 for x plus 3. Inside the absolute value, that would be negative 7 plus 3 would be negative 4. Absolute value negative 4 would be 4. So there's an example of plugging in a number for x there. So make your guess as to what you think. Like, it's going to look like that V shape. What do you think is going to have that V shape? It's going to move up and down again? Left and right? Is it going to get bigger? Absolute value of negative 4 plus 3. Negative 4 plus 3 is negative 1. And the absolute value of negative 1?
1.
Now negative 3. Negative 3 plus 3, that's 0. Absolute value of 0 is
0.
Negative 2 plus 3 is 1. Absolute value of 1?
1.
Negative 1. Look at that. See that? 1, 0, 1. Just like we had. Where did it go? And you're like 4, 3, 4. Now there's some symmetry there, some mirroring of those values. Let's see what it looks like when you graph it. And graph it. See, I got -7, 4. So -7, 1, 2, 3, 4. That was one in the example. Then -4, 1. -3, 0. -2, 1. What's it? So that is it starting to look like that original f of x, absolute value of x?
Yeah, but it's just over.
Over how much?
-3.
Over -3, okay.
I mean over 3.
Well, I guess you have to just specify what over means.
Well, I mean over to the left 3.
Over to the left 3, yeah. So, or it's to the right -3. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, sure. So to the left 3 or to the right -3, either way you think of it, it's moved to the left 3. If we had f of x up here, well, if we had the absolute value of x graph up here, it would look the same, but it would be as it always has been, right there at 0, 0.
What if you put 0 in for x?
What if you put 0 in for x? You get 0 plus 3. Absolute value of 3 is 3. And look at the graph there, 0, 3. Clint?
Oh, sorry, I'm just starting.
Right here?
Can we like try that but x plus 4? Like 4 for 3?
Instead of 3, it's a 4?
Mm-hmm.
Let's make a guess what we think will happen if we make the 3 a 4 instead.
It's gonna go over 4.
You're gonna go left 4. Let's find out. We'll do this one together quickly. X plus 4. So we make a prediction. Prediction, at least for quite a few of you, I just was hearing, is that it'll move that V shape to the left 4. There it is. And we follow that up 1, over 1,
yeah.
Up 1, to the left 1 kind of a thing.
I thought it was plus 3.
Do you see what's up there?
Yeah, why didn't you change it?
Because Bridger asked if I would.
Oh.
So let's see if it works out. If we find those 4 points. Right? I just predicted those 4 points should be there. Let's see if those 4 points are there. X and g of x. Okay. So negative 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Negative 2, negative 3, negative 4, negative 5, negative 6. Okay. To say it goes to the left 4 is kind of like also saying it's center. Do you see what I mean by the center? Its vertex, right,
mm-hmm.
is around negative 4. Clint?
Why would it work if it's just on the 4, why is it on the negative 4 side?
Instead of?
Positive 4 side.
That's a good question. Notice something about these previous graphs that we've done, okay? And notice how we can tell from the chart here at the table that we found the middle of it, okay? That we found the middle of it. Well, let's just back up here. The middle was right here in the middle of the plane, right? It was right at x is 0. I plug in 0, I take the absolute value of 0, and I know I found the center. This one too, I take the absolute value of 0, and it turns out, look at that, that's 3, you can tell this is 4, you can tell there's that symmetry there, that mirroring. When it was x plus 3 inside of the absolute value, we took the absolute value of 0 here, right, when we plugged in, negative 3.
Oh.
And it comes down to, what number will make us take the absolute value of 0?
Oh,
like when all is said and done. For this one, when all is said and done, how would I make this, like what would I plug in for x to make this the absolute value of 0? What would you have to plug in? So this comes out 0 here.
Negative 4.
So let's just start there. Negative 4 plus 4, 0, absolute value of 0, 0. -4, 0. Right? Our guess was right. We found the center of it just now. We know it's over here at -4. Because it takes a -4 to add to 4 to take the absolute value of 0. When, like if you were just randomly throw numbers into these absolute value functions, whenever you take the absolute value of 0, Just the absolute value part, not the final answer, but the absolute value part, when the inside of the absolute value comes out to be zero, you know you're in the middle of this V shape. And so negative 5 plus 4 becomes the absolute value of negative 1, which is 1. Absolute value of negative 6 plus 4 becomes the absolute value of
negative
2, which is 2. Right? And we could see if we were to keep doing this, we would get negative 6, 2, negative 5, 1, negative 4, 0. We would get negative 3, 1, negative 2, 2. So if we add something on the outside of the absolute value, it moves k higher. If we put something on the inside of the absolute value, it moves
to the left.
What if we're adding? Move to the left?
How would we move it to the right?
Negative on the left.
Negative on the inside? What do you guys think about that? Does that make sense?
Yeah, maybe.
G of x equals the absolute value of x.
Minus 3.
You think that'll move it right 3?
Mm-hmm.
We think so. And draw our prediction. Think it's going to move to the right 3 and go out like a V from there. Like that. I think it's going to be like that. You verify it by making a table. X, g of x. Okay, I think it's going to center around positive 3, so let me try like 3 in the middle, 2 to the left of that, 4 on the right of that. Absolute value of 2 minus 3. Absolute value of negative 1. Absolute value of 3 minus 3. Absolute value of 0 is 0. So there we know just by what I told you before. If the inside of the absolute value comes out to be 0, you're taking the absolute value of 0, then you know you're at the middle of that V. And 4 minus 3, absolute value of 1, 1. 3, 0, 2, 1, 4, 1. We found that symmetry, we found that middle part, we found the vertex. Okay. What I'd like to try with you now is, anybody who's misplaced this, raise your hand and I'll come by and hand you one.
Thank you.
Okay. Once you get yours out, what I want you to answer is this. Okay, so if f of x equals absolute value of x plus 6, I want you to figure out in your card which one you think it is, A, B, C, or D.
Wrong,
okay.
Do we just hold off like
Ethan?
No, I don't think you got expired gum.
How are you doing?
Ethan!
Wait,
what
are you supposed to be? Oh, wait.
Okay, so if you thought it was C, you look at your square and you put C at the top and then you hold it up so I can see it. Or whichever one you think is correct.
Shoot.
So, here we go.
Do you wear it?
You will?
You do not
hear the bell.
Yeah, I did.
Really?
Look at the time. We get out 11.
We end
out
11?
Yeah,
yeah.
We do
oh.
On
early
else.
Oh
my
gosh,
we get out. It's time for
lunch. Yeah, 2:11.
Well, I love
you
guys, though.
I'm good.
Mine's in my pants.
We go. It's time to go.
Okay.
TMI. Oh,
okay.
Pocket.
Oh, wow.
I don't want caucuses. You even know what TMI means?
Too much information.
So, according
yeah.
to results, yes. A
yes.
is the correct answer. We'll be the other two next time, which will be Monday.
Yay!
Mr. Stewart, I'm just going to put this.